Good morning.
Good morning.
I can't tell you just how nice it is to be gathered here, to see your faces, to feel like we're getting closer to normal. It is a joy and an honor and a privilege to be here with you this morning for worship. So welcome. Before we get started, I wanted to draw your attention to your bulletin this morning. You'll notice that we have an administrative council meeting on Thursday, June 24th at 6:30, and we will meet in the fellowship hall because it's cooler there this time of year. But we're hoping to get back to more regular meetings this summer now that we've eased restrictions and more people are coming back to the church, and I think it's important for us to continue with that so we can do the work of this local congregation. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to see you out today. Let's pray. Father, we welcome your presence with us today. Holy Spirit, we pray that your fruit would be in us. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And Jesus, help us to spread your fragrance everywhere we go. Through our lives and by our prayers, may your kingdom come. Amen. In the fields of the Lord, our work is rest. He is moving in our hands and feet to bless. In the fields of the Lord, in the fields of the Lord, in the fields of the Lord, our work is rest. In the vineyards of the Lord, our work is light. He is tending every leaf and every vine. In the vineyards of the Lord, in the vineyards of the Lord, in the vineyards of the Lord, our work is light. Ooh. In the garden of the Lord, our work is sound. He is weaving every thorn into a crown. In the garden of the Lord, in the garden of the Lord, in the garden of the Lord, our work is sound. At the harvest of the Lord, the fields are white, and he will wipe away the tears from every eye. At the harvest of the Lord, at the harvest of the Lord, at the harvest of the Lord, the fields are white.
Amen. I wanted to give us a moment for prayer requests and, you know, our joys and concerns. Part of getting back to or closer to normal is that we're inviting you to share those in worship today. So if anyone has any joys or concerns they'd like to share, this is the time. Yes, Sandra. Nice. That's good. That's, yes. Everyone is returning. Everyone's traveling. Yes. So thank God for that.
And they have a new dog that appeared on their jaw.
Oh, that they brought home with them.
So they made four cats and two dogs.
Other, yes, Dave.
We have the joy next weekend our daughter and our grandchildren are going to come up for a week.
Great.
But they should be here on Saturday. Hopefully everything goes to plan.
Yes.
And all. So it should be an exciting time for us. And hopefully for the people who remember TJ, our grandson, I'm going to try to get him here on Sunday morning.
Awesome.
He may want to play the piano.
Other joys or concerns anyone has? Excuse me. Along the lines of summer travel and family, Scott is not here this morning. He and Megan left for Delaware yesterday, and they, all in all, it's about 12 hours for them to drive back to her apartment and get her resettled for the rest of this summer session. She's taking one class this summer, but he and she, I'm sure, they're both recovering from the drive today. They made it safely, thanks to God, and Scott will return home tomorrow. So we could pray for a safe return for him. Any other joys or concerns? All right, let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this new season, for summertime here in Greenville, where we see friends and family members returning home or coming up to visit. God, we give you thanks for safe travels, safe arrivals, and we give you thanks for the memories that are made when our loved ones, our friends, our family members come and enjoy your creation in this place. When we get to sit around a campfire or spend a day on the lake or take a hike on one of the many trails, many mountains that are in this region. God, we know that whatever it is that we do and whomever we find ourselves gathered with, we know that you are present in us and among us. We hear you in birdsong. We feel you in the wind that whips off the lake and off the mountains. We feel you in your presence in our relationships, in our conversations. Those moments that at times, maybe at first glance, seem small and fleeting and even insignificant. And yet, when we look back, we know and we feel and we trust that that you're making every moment holy. And for that, we give you thanks this morning. We want to join our hearts and our spirits to pray for our loved ones, our friends, our family members on our prayer list, for people who are recovering from illness and surgery, for people who are lonely and still isolated due to this COVID-19 pandemic. God, we pray for your peace, your comfort, your healing. We pray that no one would feel forgotten or abandoned or left behind. So God, help us to be your hands and feet. Help us to put on Christ, to wear his righteousness and his love. And I pray that would flow out from each of us to all of our relationships, to all of our interactions, all situations, all places, all people. Help us to shine your light so that even in the darkest places, even when our brothers and sisters in Christ feel like they are walking in the valley of the shadow of death, God, I pray that we would be bold and courageous enough to stand along with them, to join arms, to hold hands, and to just to take the next step together. Help us to be people of hope and peace and reconciliation. Today we have an opportunity to share in Holy Communion together, the sacred meal, the sacred tradition. And so God, we just ask at the beginning of this service that you would search our hearts and our minds, that you would reveal to us the ways that we have fallen short of your glorious standard. And whether that is things that we've said or done, or things that we've left unsaid, undone. God, I ask that you would bring that to the surface, you would gently reveal that to us so that we can come to you, come to your throne of grace and mercy and forgiveness. So we can ask you to cleanse us once again, to make us right with you, to give us a new heart, a new spirit, to make us anew once again. God, we want to be your people. We want to be a part of what you're doing in the world, in this place. And so we invite you to meet us here this morning. Be with those of us who are able to gather in this place of worship, for which we're so grateful and so thankful. And God, I pray that you would also be with our brothers and sisters who are worshiping with us across this community, this state, this country, people who are worshiping online, who are very much a part of your body. So fill us with your spirit, transform us from the inside out, help us to look more and more like your son, Jesus, every day, every moment. We pray all these things in his name. Amen.
Our first reading this morning comes from Ezekiel chapter 17, verses 22 through 24. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of a cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of its young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel I will plant it, in order that it may produce boughs and bear fruit and become a noble cedar. Under it every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest winged creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field shall know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree, I make high the low tree. I dry up the green tree and make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken it. I will accomplish it. Our second reading comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 through 17. So we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we now know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Our gospel passage comes from the book of Mark, chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground, and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow, he does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Once again, welcome to our worship service this morning, this third Sunday after Pentecost. In reading our text for this week, I've been thinking a lot about the Holy Spirit. And since Pentecost Sunday, we've been talking more about the Holy Spirit and what it means to be connected and to have the Holy Spirit produce fruit in our lives. And I've thought about how God's Spirit accomplishes God's purposes, that the Spirit is unleashed into the world to move in and through and around God's people, people like you and like me. And this reminds me of this particular parable, this first parable that Jesus uses in Mark 4. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. He does not know how. I don't know about you, but I find comfort in those five words. He does not know how, or she does not know how. I think I can confidently say, maybe that's the only thing I can be confident and sure about, is that I do not know exactly how God's Spirit works in us and in this world. I do know that the Spirit does work and does move and is among us. But part of the mystery, which faith is nothing but mystery, right? And faith in Christ and in this journey that we walk together as believers is rooted in mystery, in holy mystery. So I know that God is renewing the face of the earth by the power of his Spirit, even as I say, I do not know how. I do not know exactly how that is working and how God is accomplishing his purposes. So even though I can't explain it, even though I'm like that farmer that scatters seed, I feel like I scratch my head sometimes and marvel and wonder at all that God is doing, I think it's still important to acknowledge, to be thankful and grateful for the fact that God is doing, God is moving. I especially like this season, this time of year, and I think many of you know that I'm pretty easy to please, so I marvel at the change in seasons, and I marvel at coming from South Texas, where there's pretty much one season, to Maine, to this region that has all four seasons. And so every year it seems to amaze me yet again that we're coming into a new season, and we see the evidence of that with our eyes, which is amazing. As the snow and ice was melting this spring and my flower beds were being uncovered and revealed, I mean, it's exciting every time. I think I was very excited. Sandra and I were very excited to see the little garden here coming back and to see those Johnny jump ups blooming pretty much underneath that snow and ice. And so as my own flower beds at home have been uncovered this spring and summer, just to see life and growth and green underneath all that snow and ice. I mean, like I said, I may be simple, easy to please, because it just amazes me every time. It feels a little bit like magic. And we acknowledge that it is independent of my efforts. So I may have put something in the ground 2 years ago, but that's all that I did, right? And then I step away and year after year, season after season, life continues and grows, and God sustains all of that creation. And so last spring, I was looking at a particular flower bed, and I had some bulbs that I knew that were going to come up, and perennials that I knew were going to come up, and things were going to be blooming, early summer, midsummer, late summer. But it took me a while to catch on that if I wanted some color right now, as soon as the snow and ice melted away, that I needed to put some annuals in there. I needed to go buy something to spruce up and brighten up my garden. And so last spring, I bought a six-pack of pansies in shades of like a cool pale pink and a deep magenta and then like a deep wine color. So it was this color palette that was just soft and beautiful and romantic, and I just loved it. And so I spread them out, every so often in my flower bed, and they were beautiful and they made me happy to look at. And so this year I was even more shocked and amazed to see that all of those pansies overwintered in my garden. And so as I was marveling at, seeing things that I knew would be beautiful later this summer, I noticed something else that I at first I thought maybe that's a weed. Maybe I need to pull that up. And I said, well, wait a minute. And as I looked closer and as the days went on, those beautiful pansies came into bloom. And again, I scratched my head and I stand there and I look down at what God can do and does do every day. And I think, just like that farmer, I do not know how. I don't know how that happens. And I know that I really have nothing to do with it. And yet I can count on that. I can count on beauty and growth and renewal and transformation every day. And it just never, never ceases to amaze me. And it brings me to the words of the Apostle Paul. So in our second reading for today that Russ read from us from the second letter to the Corinthians, it's really those last few verses of that section, right? And even, so the very last verse, verse 17, Paul says, "So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new." And so even though I look around and I marvel and I admit that I don't know how it's all working together and how God is sustaining everything and transforming everything and changing everything before my eyes. We can acknowledge and celebrate and give thanks to God for creating us anew in Christ Jesus. Again, for giving us a new heart and a new spirit, for making it possible for us to look more and more like Jesus every day, to live like him, to love like him, to extend grace and mercy and forgiveness like he does with us. So I want to ask a few questions that I want us to reflect on, which I know takes longer than just a few minutes on a Sunday morning, right? When we talk about transformation, about being made new, being a new creation, that is a lifelong process, right? A lifelong journey of scratching our heads and saying, I don't know how, but I know that it's happening. And so this new creation business, what is it like to be made a new creation? What does that mean for you in your life? What is it like for you to experience God's love and forgiveness? Because I think too often we skim over that, and we don't realize that from that well, from the love and forgiveness that we receive, that is what enables us to then extend that to others, to share that with others. How have you tasted or experienced the kingdom of heaven in your own life? God's kingdom come down to earth. What glimpses of God's kingdom have you seen in your daily life? Moment by moment, hour by hour. What ways have you been or experienced the sheltering shade of the branches of faith? So when have you been that deeply rooted tree that bears good fruit, that offers rest and shade, sanctuary for others? And when have you been on the receiving end, where you have experienced that rest and shade and sanctuary from somebody else, someone else's strong branches that sustained you and offered you a soft place to land? God alone can transform us, right? That's at the root of all scripture today that we've read and scripture as a whole, that God does the work. We do not know how, and yet we still have a role to play, right? We still have a response to what God is doing and what God has done. And so what's ours to do is to die to ourselves so that we can become that new creation, right? That we die to ourselves so that we can be raised to life again with Christ Jesus, that we actually put on Christ, that we put on his life, what he values, what he cares about, what he said is important, right, in these parables and his teachings and his words, and we put that on for ourselves. And it's really the only way forward. As a licensed local pastor, I meet with the district committee on ordained ministry once a year, and all pastors do that, but I'm a licensed local pastor, and so we talk about my calling, we talk about my education, and my continuing my education, and which I'm taking a course right now, and I told someone the other day, I'm not very good at communicating with everybody exactly what's going on in the life of a pastor, because I don't know that anybody really knew that I had started a class mid-May that is about pastoral leadership. So I'm excited to be learning a lot and to be studying and growing in that way. But in, you know, these conversations that we have as pastors every year with our district superintendent, with that committee, and they're asking us Things like, you know, our support system, who supports us as pastors, and how are we furthering our education and our growth, and how are things going in our ministry, and what are we hearing from God as far as our calling to ministry and our journey? And this year there was a question about Jesus Christ as Lord, right? And what that means to us. And the committee really wanted us, they were steering us toward acknowledging that Jesus is a Lord unlike any Lord that has ever lived or existed, right? That he is different, fully human, but fully divine at the same time. And that the way that he rules is by love. And that was at the heart of what they were getting at. And I used a lot of language about Jesus as Lord compelling me to live a certain way and requiring of me to, you know, I'm required to live a certain way. And I think the committee, they bristled a little at that because they were like, well, Jesus is not forceful, right? He doesn't make us, we get to choose. We have free will. But I really stand by that the only way forward in this life is to truly, again, put on Christ, to allow him to live in us and through us. And so we still get to choose, but when you hold those up together, life in the Spirit, life in Jesus, life to the full, right? That abundant life that he promises, abundant relationships, a new way of thinking, a new way of being in the world. I mean, that doesn't seem like a very even choice, right? So I just feel compelled. I feel that, again, that the way forward is to choose to die to ourselves so that we can be raised to new life in Christ. And what I forget sometimes, and perhaps, you know, you may forget this too, is, you know, it's easy to just say that we died to ourselves, but that's actually really hard. That's challenging. And it's not always easy that this, you know, growth can be painful, right? Growth, change, this idea of learning, of discovering a new way, again, to look at the world, to be in the world, it can be uncomfortable. It is countercultural. It can even be counterintuitive, right? Because it's saying, you know, verse 16, from now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way, right? So to allow God's Spirit to transform us and then to be willing to say, okay, I need to shed my old way of seeing, my old way of thinking, that human point of view, and instead regard everyone, regard life, regard every situation, every moment from Christ's point of view with the power of the Holy Spirit. And I wonder, you know, if I were to ask, you know, how many of us still use our human point of view when we look at other people or we look at other situations, I'd be the first to raise my hand, right? And how often does that happen? And so even though I don't always get it right, even though I don't always say the right thing or do the right thing, or I leave things unsaid or undone, I know and I trust that God is renewing me moment by moment and day by day. I trust that God's Spirit is still working on me, just like I trust that I'm gonna see all those green plants that are very much alive under that snow and ice. They get revealed to us. I trust that that is how God is working on me and in me, that he's scrubbing all the other stuff away and revealing this new creation sustained by his Spirit. And I catch glimpses of his work when I look at my relationships, my life, my work as a pastor, my friendships. I see evidence of his grace and that that new creation, that new life and new transformation every moment. And I'm grateful that I can see evidence, even if it's small, even if it's in its early growing stages, I know that it's there. I was thinking about today being our opportunity to share in Holy Communion together, and this idea of being a new creation and being transformed and looking more like Jesus. And there's a song by Natalie Grant that came out in 2015 called Clean. I don't know if you've heard it, but I was really thinking about this idea of forgiveness, grace, mercy. It's why we come to the table. It's why we gather. It's why we ask God to be among us. It's to receive. And again, from that deep well of love and forgiveness and mercy and grace, that's, you know, from there we turn around and we serve and live and love, and we're in relationship with one another. And so the chorus of this song goes like this. It says, "There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean." And that gives me hope that, again, as we walk this journey together, not always getting it right, not always shedding our human point of view, our worldview, we still have a seat at the table. We're still invited to be a part of what God is doing. He will cleanse us. He will wash us. He will make us new and make us worthy. It's why, again, we gather at this table to celebrate, to acknowledge that we need him to make us new once again, that we need him to restore us, that we need to be reconciled back to him. And so we are going to move into our time of communion together. And I'm going to be in our liturgy, in our hymnal, which the words should be up on the screen for you. And before we get started, I guess I can do a little housekeeping. So we are going to share in this holy meal together in a little bit different way. We're trying to get back to what is more normal for us. So when it is time for everyone to receive the bread and the juice, Dave is going to be our usher today, and he will lead you pew by pew to come down the center aisle to receive the bread, right? The body of Christ given for you, and then the blood of Christ given for you to receive the juice. And then you can take those back to your seat. So you'll go to your right and go around the outside aisle there so that nobody's running into the camera here. And we'll invite you to consume the elements in your seat. And so I hope that our tradition, again, this sharing of the sacred meal will start to feel more familiar to us, and that we can just be grateful to be here, to share in this together. So let us start with the invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And the church said, Amen. And now with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. I'm going to invite Sandra to come forward at this time. To serve our worship leaders, and then I will invite Dave to start leading you forward. Rest, this is the body of Christ given for you.
His blood.
Andy, this is the body of Christ given for you.
His blood, which is shed.
Thank you. Again, I think I could cry being able to come face to face with each of you, to share in that holy moment, to call you by name, to know that that is what God does with us, that he calls us by name, and that he offered his son for us. The bridge of the song I mentioned, Clean, by Natalie Grant, goes like this. It says, washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags are purified. I'm clean, I'm clean. So friends, we are purified, we are made new, we are made clean, not by anything that we can do, not by anything that we can even fully understand or explain, right? We're still like that farmer scratching our heads saying, I know not how, but I know that God indeed is in this place, is moving in each of us, and that it's made possible by the life, death, resurrection, by the love of Jesus Christ given to us. So I invite you to go out into the world, a world that is desperate for mercy and grace and love and forgiveness. I pray that we would put on Christ and that we would all lean and live fully into the fact that we are made a new creation. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.